Hi everyone, here's a quick video interview I did with violinist Nick Kendall of Time for Three about their new album and about the future of classical music. Hey everybody, I'm here today with Nick Kendall, and for those of you that don't know, he is one of the two fabulous violinists from Time for Three. Hi Nick, how are you doing today?
I'm very good, it's good to talk to you, Caeli.
Good to talk to you. So, we are doing a video chat today to talk a little bit about your new album, which we are all on the edge of our seats waiting to hear. When does it drop?
Well, let's see. The album comes out on the 24th, which is just June 24th, which is just right around the corner. And
Tuesday.
Yeah, Tuesday. Gosh, that's Tuesday. Yeah. We're really excited about it, and it's a big moment in our life.
So tell us a little bit about the album and what's
sure. Well, I mean, as you know, we've always known the value and just the energy that comes from collaboration. You know, just coming from the classical music tradition, chamber music has always been something very natural to us, and also chamber music in a variety of different formations. Also, in Time for Three's particular case, you know, the three of us grew up listening to and having a multitude of different musical experiences. And so the idea of this album, besides there are a lot of tracks that are just new compositions and new arrangements, but the idea of this album was to collaborate with artists that maybe are as disparate as our musical tastes. So our featured guest actually is Joshua Radin, who it's amazing that he agreed to be on the album. He basically gave us four songs from his first album that sort of broke him for us to rearrange. And we're really excited about those songs. I mean, that's how I got to know Josh.
What was the story of how you began your collaboration with him?
Well, right, so everybody on the album we know personally, we've either collaborated with or have met, but with Joshua Radin and I was hanging out, I think on the east side, the lower east side in New York City, and he was just like minding his own business way in the corner of this cafe, and I saw him, and I had always imagined what it would sound like with a lush string sound around his voice, kind of in the center of the mix, and then the sound of strings around him. So I went right to him, and I said, I know you have no idea who I am, but have you ever played with classical musicians and especially strings? And he looked at me and said, no, but I'd love to. Who are you? So I was able to pitch him right there a compelling idea, and his whole team got behind it, and first and foremost, he did. We invited him actually to our series in Indianapolis called Happy Hour, and he joined us for a show there. The concert hall was inundated by his fans, mm-hmm. who were so excited that he was, you know, playing with classical musicians. And mm-hmm. from that point on, we invited him, would you be willing to be on our album? And that's when he gifted us with those four songs. So that's really exciting.
Oh, very cool.
Jake Shimabukuro, one of the nicest, caring, loving human beings on planet Earth. He's a ukulele virtuoso. He's on one track. Our longtime friend, Elisa Weilerstein, who actually Zach and I studied with the Don for a couple of years. Yes. So she's playing a new version of Vocalese that we asked Kenji Bunch, who's a composer from New York. He actually lives in Portland, Oregon, to rearrange, and it's a really seriously gorgeous arrangement. We think will be a major part of the contribution to the classical repertoire. Branford Marsalis from the Marsalis family, he's on a track. It's inspired. Well, Renan actually wrote the main material. Renan and I both worked on it. The song mm-hmm. is called Queen of Voodoo. It's like a dark funk kind of New Orleans kind of party and music, and Branford just blows over it. I mean, it's really amazing. Let's see, am I missing? Oh yeah, and then a duo sister group, Lily and Madeline. We found them. They're now up and coming and going to have a big career. They're signed to Sufjan Stevens' label, Asthmatic Kitty. But they rearranged Danny Boy, and we also did a nice little bed of string texture underneath it. We're really excited about them. And they, I honestly feel like they're the modern day female version of Simon and Garfunkel. Just pure beauty, and they're beautiful themselves, and they're kind. So really excited. And we also have different collaborators on the album. We have guitar, tenor guitar, regular guitar. We have a bandoneon player. We have a percussionist. We have B3 organ. It's pretty awesome.
Wow, so you really have it all covered. You have it all on the new album, it seems.
it's a new direction for sure for us. But it's in a voice and a new texture that we're really excited about.
Very cool. So Time for Three represents something really special to the next generation of classical musicians. Having just graduated from conservatory myself, I'm always thinking about new venues and new places to play and new kinds of people to play with, all different sorts of projects and collaboration. And I think that you guys really broke the mold in some ways and have opened up the minds of a lot of young classically trained musicians to all these new opportunities and ideas that maybe they wouldn't have occurred to them before. So it's really, yeah.
Well, I thank you very much. I mean, I think we find ourselves in this kind of weird place. I mean, if you asked us 14 years ago if we would be doing what we're doing now, I mean, we would laugh in your face. I think it's an exciting future. I think there's an audience out there. Well, there is definitely an audience out there that, you know, that just the number one thing I think people listening to us want to feel is that it's authentic music making. Mm-hmm. If it's an arrangement of UFO by Coldplay, if it's a minimalist, texturized, kind of like an ostinato passage, or if it's a movement of Beethoven or this Adagietto from Mahler, I mean, it's so long as it's has conviction and it's real and it's coming from, it's communicating something through music, anybody can get it. And, you know, we are grateful for the accolades for what we've done, but I think I just look at all of these conservatory trained students, and, you know, the conversation is very realistic that conservatories are putting out more incredibly highly talented and able students than there are jobs for classical music. But the thing is that I sometimes feel that when those of us who have studied classical music feel that if we're not playing the classics, that somehow we're not living up to a projected standard.
Right.
And I'm starting to really ask this question, you know, I've been starting to ask this question to conservatory, just graduated conservatory students. Mm-hmm. I ask the very simple question, what is the point of classical music? And if you really think about that, it's hard to answer, but I feel like it's an important question to ask, because everybody out there, the market, you know, if we're talking business terms and we're talking about trying to find a way to express yourself when you're classically trained, it's about playing beautifully. And it's about utilizing everything that we've learned and spent and sacrificed hours of our young life practicing for to perfect our technique. But our technique always needs to serve the music. And there's not, you know, I'd rather see somebody playing solo violin Bach a little bit more scrappy or a little bit more on the edge and soulful and really getting in and communicating with it than I would see a performance of somebody who is projecting the importance of Bach. Now, that is not to say that these composers were and are the geniuses, some of the most incredible geniuses and craftspeople that have ever existed. But they're giving us a gift. They're giving us a roadmap, a way to communicate. And yes, communicating authentically a Beethoven sonata is a lot more complicated, and you have to ingrain it, and you have to think about it and know the score and be really listening to the harmonies and reacting to the harmonies, much more maybe our arrangement of UFO, but it's coming, it needs to come from the exact same place, and the output and how you're sharing it needs to be for the same reason. Yeah. It's about connecting. So I'm sort of going a little bit on and on here, but I think it's...
No, you're making excellent points. And it's really, I think this stuff is really important for me and my colleagues and peers and anyone that's even younger that's training in the classical tradition to hear about and be thinking about all the time as we are living in the time that we are living in, and things are ever evolving. And it's actually really, I think it's, people get really down about how it's so hard to be a classical musician or a musician of any kind, and I think that's true, but I also think this is a great time to be a classical musician. There's more opportunity than ever before. There are new ways to
connect. Absolutely.
We're doing this cool video chat thing that didn't exist.
I know, totally 21st century.
There's lots of stuff to explore. So,
you know, one thing I feel is a great, an idea for people who are just graduating, who are trying to make a living. If you ever get an opportunity to play a gig, whether it's a wedding gig, background music, especially like in the big cities like New York City or LA or Washington, D.C., first of all, yes, have a variety of different music, but it's a huge opportunity with those people to play music that is popular but with excellent arrangements. And if you actually practice the arrangements, sound good, and you know, if you play, I don't know, pick a Lorde song or Lady Gaga or a Beyonce song, take the melody, but then develop the melody later and then bring it back home, I'll guarantee you that those people at the reception will be interested in knowing who you are. I think it's a huge opportunity for well-trained, classically trained musicians to get into a market.
Yeah.
And how many times do string quartets get played, get asked to play for wedding gigs or for receptions, especially in New York? Probably, and the money that's being spent on it is a lot. So I would say to all of you guys, get great arrangements of these songs and use that opportunity to test the market and to try it and see how you feel. But when it actually sounds good and you practice it, that would be my suggestion as an interesting way to get yourself into a new territory.
That is such good advice. Thank you, Nick. That is really useful for everyone to hear, I think. Awesome. Very cool. So, your concert Monday night at Joe's Pub
kicks off
your month-long tour across the country.
Yes, well, I understand that probably you and a lot of your friends are probably off to music festivals for the summer, but we are very excited about Monday the 23rd, the eve of our release of our album. Monday the 23rd, June 23rd, at Joe's Pub at 7:30 p.m., and this will kick off our summer of representing the album and also just other arrangements. Some old stuff, but some new arrangements, some mashups that we put together. Very excited. Also, check with our website because we're going to be all over the country. Actually, Josh Radin is going to be joining us in Sun Valley later this summer, Sun Valley, Idaho, and with the Indianapolis Symphony on our last Happy Hour show. We're going to be City Winery in Chicago. We're going to be Minneapolis. We're going to be at Club Yoshi's in San Francisco, Texas Music Festival in a couple weeks. So it's a busy schedule, but we'd love to see everybody there and spread the word.
Good. Great. Well, so exciting. I hope that you and Zach and Renan have a great tour. Congratulations on the new album. We're all waiting to listen to more than the little sneak previews from the iTunes. It's like you're listening to it and it's beautiful and then it fades away.
But it fades so nicely. iTunes does such a good job of, like, you know. But thank you, Caeli. Appreciate this very much, this opportunity.
Absolutely. It's fun chatting, Nick, and I will see you soon, hopefully.
Sounds good.
Bye, everybody.
Bye.